But we have a packed house, and this is only half of it. There are more people out there and more people streaming online across the nation. And on behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center and Merritt College, I would like to welcome you to the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series. My name is Royal Roberts, and I'm the Director of Operations and a board member at the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center, and I'll be the MC for the evening. Chaos or community? Where do we go from here? Chaos is a state of utter confusion or disorder, or a total lack of organization or order. Community, a group of associated people sharing a common interest or a common heritage or common goals. Chaos or community, where do we go from here? Tonight, we have the honor of welcoming the founding chairman and national organizer of the Black Panther Party, originally known as the Black Panther Party of Self-Defense, Mr. Bobby Seale. Again, we would like to thank you for being here tonight, and we want to thank all of those who may not have been able to fit into this room, but maybe in another room on campus, and again, those who are able to live stream this event. After tonight's lecture, in the hall lobby, we will have books, DVDs, and posters for sale by Mr. Seale. Some of those items are autographed as well. So, and if you didn't bring cash, there's also ATM a little bit further down the hall.
I like that headline.
At this time, I would like to recognize the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center's Board of Directors, as well as its chairman, Mr. Rod Lee. I would also like to recognize the tireless efforts of, first, the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center's Director of Government and External Relations, Dr. Karen Bulkey. And I would also like to recognize the Freedom Center's Executive Director, who works day in and day out with the youth to really make a difference. And hats off to Dr. Roy Wilson. Events like tonight could not take place without the support of individual contributors, sponsors, and donors. Some of the names you saw presented on the board prior to this event starting. Some of them are listed in your program, but I want to give special thanks and gratitude to a few of our supporters, contributors, and sponsors. First, I would like to recognize our supporters, Coliseum Lexus and East Bay Regional Park District. Next, I would like to thank our contributing sponsors, East Bay Community Foundation, the Institute for Community Leadership, Pandora, Safeway, and TCOM Design. And next, I would like to thank our major sponsor, the California Endowment. Finally, I would like to welcome all of the elected officials who have joined us tonight. And as you can imagine, with this many people coming in, We may miss a name or two, and if so, raise your hand and know that you're in our heart as well. We have Supervisor Keith Carson. We have Chancellor Laguerre from Caprona Community College District. We also have with us tonight Pastor A.G. and Pastor Van Hook. And again, if we forgot anyone, we want to thank you for your public service and your service to the community and all you do on a daily basis. And I did not forget our Congresswoman, who will get her due later on in the program. So don't think I forgot. Or the Honorable Elihu Harris, who will be introduced a little bit later in the program. Thank you. At this time, I want to welcome up to the stage the president of Merritt College, this beautiful institution that we are so blessed to be in this evening. Dr. Norma Ambriz Galaviz has been in education for over 30 years, serving in various positions such as counselor, instructor, program coordinator, director, in various leadership roles, even including some of the accreditation process for other junior colleges and other institutions. She has been the president of Merritt College since 2013 when she was appointed. Prior to coming to Merritt College, she served as the vice president of instruction for Mission College in Santa Clara and was employed for 17 years at Chabot College. She does a great job, and at this moment, I would like you to help me welcome up Dr. Norma Ambriz Galaviz.
Good evening. Boy, it's such a wonderful pleasure to see the outpour and the interest in hearing our keynote speaker. And we know why. But let me take a moment first. On behalf of the faculty and our staff and our students, and of course our elected Board of Trustee members, our chancellor, our colleagues. I know Dr. Joy Blake is here from College of Alameda. Very much interested in welcoming all of you. Thank you very much for attending. We're extremely proud of our relationship with the Martha Luther King Freedom Center and the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series. They bring a wealth of opportunity to engage our community with keynote speakers, and this is definitely one of them. We do have standing room only, and we have individuals, as they said, in the other room and with an opportunity to view what we're going to see today, not only on the video, but also hear from our keynote speaker. The pleasure of having Bobby Seale here is the pleasure because he is no stranger to Merritt College. As many of you know, Merritt College was able to be placed on the map because of his work and Newton's work. Because of their work with the Black Panther, we are proud to call this the home of the Black Panthers. And why? Because of that work, of that interest in sharing and in placing an importance in education. You know, Merritt College was able to hire its first African-American president, Dr. Norrell Smith, and it established its first program for African-American studies, unknown in the 60s. So for us to have that recognition nationwide is a tremendous honor, and we respect it, and we continue to honor it to this day and develop it even further. That program develops in students a more widespread ethnic studies program that we have currently under the leadership of Dr. Siri Brown, who is doing an excellent job of expanding it. And you'll be hearing a little later, if you don't have the announcements out there, we are doing a grand opening at the end of March for the Africana Center. So I want you to come back, visit the Africana Center. You'll have an opportunity to do hands-on work, just like a regular museum. Technology's built in there, but you get to look into the history, your own history. You have an opportunity to personalize it to yourself. So it's a great opportunity to visit us and come back at the end of the month. So again, our opportunity to listen to a gentleman who again created and believed and fostered the opportunity to have individuals follow and understand the importance of freedom, justice, and equity, because it transcends racial and ethnic barriers. And that's what Merritt College represents. Thank you very much, and I look forward to your invite.
Okay, at this time, I would like to welcome one of our Freedom Center students. This young man is a student at Oakland Military Institute, and I would like you to help me give a warm welcome to Mr. Joel Dibb.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Joel Martin Dill. On behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center, we welcome you to the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris lecture featuring Bobby Seale. Welcome to you, Mr. Seale. It is an honor to work with you. Thank you, Dr. Norma Ombres Galaviz, President of Merritt College, for all the work that you do in the field of education. It is a privilege to partner with Merritt College. We thank both the Honorable Elihu Harris and Congresswoman Barbara Lee for your continuous guidance as we young people grow and develop to become effective leaders. The freedom. The Freedom Center fosters learning about the struggle for people power and the continuing vision of Dr. King and other leaders in the movement for civil and human rights. The center also supports economic development, providing opportunities for internships and career training. We provide guidance to create interracial, intergenerational, and international relationships. Our work focuses on confronting racism, poverty, and violence of all kinds, from war to domestic violence. We do this by studying the history of the struggle for social justice and by direct involvement in civic engagement. Dr. King said in 1968, "We have some dark days ahead." We believe he envisioned the type of conflict and struggle we are confronted today. This year, 2016, the battle between who want to move back the advances of our people and those who demand we go forward to promote just society. It's really a battle between the forces of darkness and those of light. We are committed to being deeply engaged in this battle for ourselves, our community, in our planet. Thank you and enjoy the evening.
Thank you, Joe. At this time, I'm going to bring up the Honorable Elihu Harris. But when you say the Honorable, some people go, why the Honorable? But there's reasons behind that when we say that. Elihu Harris served for 12 years as a member of the California State Assembly. And in that time, he authored the historic 1981 legislation designating Dr. King's birthday as a California state holiday. After serving in the California State Assembly, he went on to become the 46th mayor of the city of Oakland. And after that, to go on to become the chancellor of the Peralta Community College District. When we think of leaders, we think of those who are doing things now, but we also look at those who are paving a way and building bridges for those who will come after them. And although some may say that Elihu Harris, the Honorable Elihu Harris, has retired, we know that he is still positively working to shape the lives of youth and people older for days to come. Please help me welcome the Honorable Elihu Harris to the stage.
Well, thank you very much to the Chancellor, to the President, certainly to all of the Merritt community and our great community. I'm very happy to be here, not only to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Black Panthers, but to remind you that the struggle continues.
Yes. Yes.
Let me take you back just a moment. By the way, if you haven't seen Merritt College, Home of the Black Panthers, which is a film produced by Jeff Heyman and my wife, Dr. Seale. Well, you ought to look at that so you really get a pictorial glimpse of young people 50 years ago making a change, taking a stand, putting their lives at risk because it was that important to make a change. If you don't have that in your heart, as Martin Luther King said, if you don't have something that you're willing to die, you're not fit to live. Mm. So think about your contributions. Think about what you do every day. Think about what you do every day. Because any of you who think you live in a post-racial America are very confused. A lot of us think that we got nice cars, some of us live in nice neighborhoods, some of us got good jobs. The things have changed. The things are very much the same. 50 years ago, Bobby Seale and Huey Newton and the Black Panthers confronted racial police officers. You think that changed in Oakland?
No.
You think that changed in America?
No.
It probably hasn't changed. And it won't change. But black lives have not only got to matter to the police, they got to matter to us too. Learning. 50 years ago, I was in high school, and I saw Huey Newton and Bobby Seale and David Hilliard, and all those guys were just a little older than I was, but they were on the streets, talking, organizing, doing things in community service that I thought was admirable. But I said, well, I'm too young, it's too dangerous, I'm not going to get out there like those fools. I'm going to college. They were already in college, they were doing. So if you're in college, you're just getting an education, but you're not serving your community, you're not really getting an education. So I want to tell you, I'm happy. Oh, by the way, for those of you who came to Merritt College tonight, it's a beautiful campus. But you saw the most lit up building on the campus, you know it's named after Barbara Lee. It's Barbara Lee School of Allied Health. And when I was in college with Barbara Lee, when I got out of law school, I had a job. But Barbara Lee gave me another job. She didn't pay anything, but you know how she is. Barbara Lee and Berkeley started the community health, it's changed, it's community health,
Alliance for Neighborhood
Health Alliance for Growth and Education. In West Berkeley, to families to get counseling, for mental health, for families to stay together. I mean, even as a student, she understood what change was all about, before even she dreamed of being an elected official. As I said before, when I was in the state legislature, for the last 10 years I was there, every day I saw Barbara Lee, she said, when are you going to get out of my seat? When I ran for mayor, she said, well, it's about time. As you know, she went to the legislature. She served there in the Assembly and the State Senate. And then after that, here's where she is now, our congresswoman, the only woman who had the courage to vote against the war in Iraq. And she's still fighting against the Republicans. You're talking about the evil empire. Even though John Boehner was there, let Donald Trump become president. He is your father. And when they say they want to make America great again, you know what they're saying? They want to turn back the clock. They want to go back to pre-civil rights. They want to go back to pre-voting rights. They want to go back to segregation. They want to put us back in the bus and out of the country. And I'm telling you, if you don't stand up now, you're going to sit down for a long time after that. In November, is who's going to be the president? You are out of your mind. That seat on the Supreme Court is going to determine all of our lives. You have to be by politics as you. We are not in that era anymore. We're fighting for power and control. The Panthers fought for black power. We need to fight for human power and the human race. We're about to go back to the Neanderthal caveman days. This is going to get us all. I remember Bob Seale preaching on the corner. He would stand on anything he could find. A chair, a brick, anything a little taller than the pea crowd he was talking to. He would speak the truth to power. He put his life on the line in prison. I mean, you can't begin to believe the kind of courage that he and the Black Panthers had in the 60s and 70s. When you're under invasion by the FBI and the CIA and all the other cloaks of darkness that we have in this country, you have the courage to continue to fight? What manner of strength and what manner of man do you have in front of us today? I used to go to the meeting, I'd sneak in and sneak out before the FBI saw me. I was scared to death. Those guys, you know, and there were a whole lot of pretenders to the Panthers. People who wore berets and had leather coats, man, they didn't have nothing to do with the Panthers. They walk behind them like they were in the crowd. You know? And then they peel off when the trouble started. Well, Bobby Seale, we're just so blessed that you're here today, that you're alive, you're well, you can share your knowledge and your history with all of us. The people who you know who you are, what you did, and what we need to do to maintain your legacy. Brother, we are in the Bob Seale and Huey Newton Lounge at Merritt College. It's named after you. Take pride in being here tonight. You have pride in your life and your legacy. Thank you.
Heat it up. At this time, I would like to welcome up a group of Freedom Center students. At this time, I want you to help me welcome this group here. And they represent a larger group that deserve everyone's applause and support. Thank you.
Quintana. At the Freedom Center, we support and inspire one another. We love one another. One way we show our love is through coaching. We believe everyone can coach and everyone can receive coaching comments with appreciation. However, first, a coach must be able to change oneself in order to help change others. Secondly, we must also learn to trust one another so that we know that we can become our own desired self. We receive coaching comments so that we know we can become the person that we hope and desire to be. A nonviolence coach does not coach one another so they can change to be like the coach. They coach so that being the coach can become their own better self for their community. By giving coaching comments, we help each other become more successful. Coaching is different than teaching. Yes. Teaching is important too. We are also teachers at the Freedom Center. However, here's the difference. We see it as a way of giving love than criticizing their work. We also see it as focusing on their relationship with the student and their conduct. Whereas a teacher focuses more on the given material. A teacher focuses on the absorption of feedback from their student, whereas a coach focuses on what they do and how they do it. Furthermore, a coach focuses on the overall benefit to a student. Coaching affects our everyday conduct. Conduct, that is how we act. It is a first step to a higher consciousness. Our conduct is the way we choose to behave.
That's right.
In every situation, we have the option to conduct ourselves in a way that's other-interested or self-interested. Our conduct either lowers or rises our character. It defines who we are. When we act in a way that lowers our character, we lower our consciousness. Low character leads to being blind to the needs and interests of others. But what is the best interest of the nation? Our world, higher character leads to more enlightened consciousness, and one can see farther. Our world vision expands, and we cannot see only the interests of others, but what is the best interest of the nation and humanity. Being able to have the consciousness to see and interpret our world begins with conduct. And such conduct can be very basic. For example, a smile.
That's one.
A smile is basic conduct that leads towards hope and support.
Yes.
When we smile, we permit others to feel hope and security. When we help others feel hope, we begin to see farther ahead and further around us. We coach ourselves to conduct ourselves in a way that rises character and amplifies consciousness. Thank you.
Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Jake Harrison, and here at the Freedom Center, we learn to master our fears. We learn that fear is good. It is not something to be avoided. After all, isn't it our fear of getting burned that stops us from touching that hot stove? Isn't it our fear of falling that keeps us from getting too close to that dangerous ledge?
All right.
At the Freedom Center, we're taught how to make fear our friend, and we learn how to avoid abnormal fear. Rational fear simply warns us, while abnormal fear paralyzes us. It stops us from doing what we know is right. And right now, as a country, we're living in a state of perpetual fear. This is fear that needs to be confronted, not avoided.
Go, Jake.
At the Freedom Center, we're taught how to utilize our fear to work for us instead of against us. For fear is a tool of warfare. And right now, currently, our nation is under a violent assault on our mental health. Those in the establishment instill fear in our everyday lives to stifle our revolution.
Yes.
Here at the Freedom Center, we learn to conquer our fear so we can fight another day. At the Freedom Center, we're also taught about the importance of staying relevant. And when we say relevant, we're not talking about keeping up with the latest fashion trends. We're not talking about buying the newest album that was just dropped. We're talking about keeping up with the economic, political, and cultural development that happen around us every day. Staying relevant means avoiding all the constant distractions that are thrown our way and continuing to stay focused on the bigger picture. At the Freedom Center, we are taught to be cognizant of the world that we all share, because change is not inevitable. We have to force it to happen. And we create change by getting involved. Here at the Freedom Center, we remain relevant to continue the revolution. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Angela Drake. And at the Freedom Center, we devote time to understanding interconnectedness. We are all interdependent, whether we know it or not. It could be something as obvious as depending on the person next to you or someone from across the world. That's how humanity is structured. When you cook for your family, it's not just you in the kitchen. It's a kitchen full of work, sweat, and contribution of millions of others. The oranges on the counter have been picked by a farm worker, processed and packed in a packing plant by workers who, in many countries, work hard without a living wage. Your coffee comes from Latin America, your tea from a Chinese, and the spices in your cupboard come from all around the world. Even the kitchen towel comes from an Indonesian girl who works 10 hours a day under slave conditions for a towel she cannot even afford. That same towel that you wipe your hands with every single day. And it's up to us to remember the ones who help. Every day before we leave the house, we are using half of the world. From everything you touch, every going through your daily routine, we're touching Africa, Asia, China, all over the world, Europe, and we don't even acknowledge the fact that we're touching half of the world. So at the Freedom Center, we like to do an exercise. And in this exercise, it's going to require you to get to know your neighbor. So can everybody please turn to your neighbor and get to know them right now?
College now. Like my friends and teammates, I would probably not be actively engaged in fighting racism and poverty if it wasn't for the Freedom Center that's been supporting me for the past years. Most likely, I would be pregnant. I would be working to somehow pay the rent and eat at the same time. I would be surviving, not living. I would be taking myself out, along with my younger sisters and my children. See, this is the reality. Most of us came to the Freedom Center knowing that we can't do this on our own. We need each other. We know that if we don't change ourselves, the ramifications go far beyond our lives. It follows us into our wombs, homes. It follows us into our classrooms. It follows us into our jobs. In America, our inability to change ourselves, place a role in maintaining the status quo, which increases racism, poverty, and war. Some adults have negative views of us youth, but you know what? Many of us young people also hold negative views about ourselves, and we have to change. So please get ready to give as much as you can. If you can write a check for $100, do so. If you can give $25, that helps us reach out to another student. We must become the force demanding change. We need people power, and we need support. We're in the struggle together. So, if you have not taken out your checkbook or wallet, do so now. All of us at the Freedom Center are profoundly changing ourselves so that all of us can be lifelong learners. So that all of us not only vote, but also engage in a political campaign. So that not only we learn how to organize, but we also organize another free breakfast program, another life-saving clinic, and more civil rights lecture series. We're changing ourselves so that all of us have decent housing, so that all of us have a choice and the opportunity to be the next revolutionary doctors, lawyers, elected officials, teachers, mothers, and fathers. Let's partner up, young and old. We're worth your investment. It's worth your sustained support. It's worth you donating tonight, tomorrow, next month, next year. So as we pass along the basket, we're going to be playing a really special song. It's called Chicago. It was written for Bobby Seale, and it's about the brutality he received in court in 1968 after his participation in the demonstrations at the 1968 Democratic National Convention. Whatever you contribute today, anything, will be really greatly appreciated. Okay. So please give generously. Thank you. The students will now pass the basket.
Thank you. Again, as Myra put it so eloquently, we would not be able to do what we do without the support. And we just want, again, thank you all for the generous contributions you made tonight. And they will go to a great place into furthering the development of young leaders in our community. Again, can you all just give yourself an applause for the donations that you made? At this time, I have the honor and the privilege of introducing the congressperson who speaks for me, and she speaks for you. Congresswoman Barbara Lee. I'm still gonna say it. Barbara Lee speaks for me. Here she is.
Power to the people! Good evening. It's good to be home. Gosh, first, Dr. Norma Ambriz-Galavis, thank you so much for your continuing support and leadership of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center, as well as this great community college. So give Norma another round of applause. Really appreciate your diligence and commitment. And also to our Chancellor LaGuerre, thank you so much. I tell you, you're continuing to lead Peralta in its reputation of excellent education for this community, for young people, middle-aged people, older people. You know, this Peralta Community College is a community college system that everyone in the country wants to know about, and they're jealous of, because you do it right. And so thank you for making sure that our students here are prepared not for the jobs of yesterday, but for the jobs of tomorrow. So thank you so much. And also, sometimes we forget, we don't have any of our great historically black colleges and universities west of the Mississippi, but Merritt is what we finally got designated a predominantly black institution, a PBI. And so the only one west of the Mississippi. So we're eligible for a lot of what we would not get if it hadn't been then Chancellor Harris. When he was here, that's when we got that designation. First, and to Elihu and to Seale, let me just thank you first for your friendship, but also for your constant and consistent support and help for our young people at the Freedom Center. And I always say Elihu and Seale could be doing other things, but they're still on the case, working each and every day, making sure that our young people have a future, the future that they deserve. Now, I met Elihu I'm not gonna tell too many stories about you, Elihu, tonight, but he was a student, I was a student in Mills College. You were at Bolt then, I think, UC Berkeley. And some of our deepest and most, I would say, enthusiastic discussions had to do with the Black Panther Party, because I was out there with Bobby and Elaine and Erica and Huey as a community worker. And Elihu and I, we used to debate and talk about the role and the importance of the Black Panther Party. And it was during that period that I really, first of all, met Shirley Chisholm and registered to vote. But it was also during the early 70s that I met then Chairman Comrade Bobby Seale. It was during that period, and I want to remind us of a couple of things tonight, just in terms of the history of Bobby and the Black Panther Party. First of all, the Black Panther Party, under the leadership of Bobby Seale and Huey Newton, they initiated what now the federal government finally decided to do, and that was the free breakfast programs for children. Took the Panthers to do that. Took them to do that. Back, the Black Panther Party highlighted the issue of police misconduct and police brutality. way back then. And Bobby, I just have to say, today we had the Oscar Grant Foundation with at least 12 to 15 mothers of young men who have been killed by the police throughout the country. And it was quite a moving and powerful meeting today. But I had to, and Erica was there, and I had to think about what you all were doing and saying way back then in the day about the role of the police in our community and police misconduct. And so the Panthers, once again, led the way on all of these very, very tough issues that we're still dealing with today. They were the vanguard of the revolution, the vanguard party of the revolution. Also, it was during that period in the early 70s when the Black Panther Party decided that they wanted to exercise their political power. And Bobby, I'll never forget, I was his fundraising coordinator when he ran for mayor of Oakland. They had the best precinct operation and grassroots organized effort in the city of Oakland or anywhere I have ever seen in the country. And Bobby made it into the runoff, and that paved the way for our first African-American mayor to be elected, Mayor Lionel Wilson. But had it not been for Bobby Seale, that never would have happened. Never would have happened. Also, during that period, I mentioned that I had first time registered to vote for Shirley Chisholm with Sandre Swanson, Wilson Rounds Jr., Sandy Gaines. Well, the Black Panther Party and Bobby Seale and Huey Newton and Elaine and Erica and all the comrades in the party, they endorsed Shirley Chisholm for president. We took almost 10% of the vote in Alameda County. And I just have to tell you, Shirley Chisholm used to talk to me about how proud she was, Bobby, of your endorsement of her in her presidential campaign and how badly needed the Black Panther Party was during that period. And so she was bold, she was visionary, and she stood with Bobby Seale throughout that time. The young people at the Freedom Center, I just have to say to them how proud I am of all of you. They are amazing young people who I have gotten to know. They travel with me. I have the privilege to go with John Lewis and others to the pilgrimage to Selma, Montgomery, Birmingham every year. We're getting ready to go to Charleston in a couple of weeks. They went with me to Memphis when we reopened the Civil Rights Museum. So these young people have a chance to move around the country and to meet our heroes and sheroes and foot soldiers and leaders of the Civil Rights Movement. When we went to Memphis, Tennessee with the Freedom Center, Bobby Seale came. Bobby spoke at the opening of the Civil Rights Museum. And Bobby, I'm just so proud of the fact that you were there speaking and that the Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee has a major exhibit about Bobby Seale and the Black Panther Party in Oakland, California, in Memphis. And of course, our young people with the Freedom Center, they were on the front page of the newspaper all over the country walking in the parade as we reopened the Civil Rights Museum. So I want you to know these are wonderful ambassadors for Oakland and for the East Bay, all of our young people here at the Freedom Center. They go all around the world, you know, making us very proud. We started the Freedom Center in the 90s, Ira Dinkins, Charlie Mae Davis. We, the young people and our senior citizens, came to Sacramento and said they wanted to have a center for nonviolence, conflict resolution, mediation, and the environment. And we actually worked then with Pete Wilson, the governor. But he did sign the memorandum of understanding, but it was because busloads of people from Oakland, California, young people, senior citizens, came to Sacramento and said, we want to have a Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center. And they did it. And that was their first exertion of political power. So I just have to say, you guys have withstood the test of time. So please support the Freedom Center, because they make us so proud with everything that they do. And so now I just want to bring forward the man of the hour, the person who I have known for many, many, many years. Where's my nephew? Lamont is here from Los Angeles. He remembers Bobby Seale and all of us out selling newspapers and survival rallies and the chairman really conducting the PE classes we all went to. I mean, Bobby Seale was a community worker, but he was also chairman of the Black Panther Party. And so he educated this community like many of you remember and believe. And now with Black Lives Matter, which Black Lives Matter? Black Lives Matter. Elihu and I and Roy and Karen and the staff of the Martin Luther King Freedom Center couldn't think of any person more relevant to this time, more appropriate to be with us tonight during Black History Month, more clear and more committed as he has ever been to make sure that Black Lives Matter and that we see the change of this country that the Black Panther Party stood for, worked for, fought for, and many, many, many sacrificed so much for. So Bobby Seale, thank you. We honor you tonight. Come on up, Mr. Chairman, Comrade Bobby Seale. Power to the people, all power to the people. Give Bobby Seale a round of applause.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you. I'm looking around here to see that I see the other members of my family. Did they get here? Abraxas, Shelley, besides my daughter and my wife outside? Oh, okay, they're over there. No, I can't see. thank you. You know, I get up every morning and I go to the gym. I've been doing this since I was 47. And of course, I stopped drinking beer and smoking so many years ago. But it was like I had things to do, you know what I mean? And I cannot run down my system anymore. And I look around and see various things happening. You know, Nelson Mandela came out of prison. And I remember myself going to San Francisco. There was a South African sort of a consulate extension of the United Nations place in San Francisco where we protested. It's the first time I carried a placard. 1963, and they came down and arrested us, put us in a paddy wagon, drove us 10, 12 blocks away, and let us out of the paddy wagon. We went back and forth. Later, we was up around University of California getting petitions signed to end apartheid and free Nelson Mandela. This was in 1963. In 1962, I was a young man. I was working at Kaiser Aerospace Electronics. Kaiser Industries is right here. And I landed this great job. You know, my whole career, a life of work. It's like I was a lucky young guy, you know, to be raised a carpenter and a builder. Beginning at age 7 when my father built our first house in Port Arthur, Texas. He built it from the ground. My father was a master carpenter and builder. My grandfather was a master carpenter and builder, Art Seale. And we come from the Seale family, from the Seale plantation in East Texas. This is where both my mother and father were born. They were born in the county of Jasper, Texas. The same county where some 15, 20 years ago a young brother was drugged to death by Ku Klux Klaners. And my niece, my daughter, my sister's daughter, looked up our genealogy and found that that brother who was drugged to death was 6 cousins to our family. My people are from Jasper, Texas. My grandpa built the town. Well, he built 500 houses in what we call Weargate, Texas, near the Louisiana border. These old men that I grew up with, they taught me. My father taught me to be a hunter and a fisherman. I mean, it's like when I was 13 years of age, I was an expert shot with a 30-30 Winchester, hunting deer, hunting bear, what have you, et cetera. Of course, we hunted all over California, small game, big game, what have you, et cetera. But me, I was lucky. I was lucky because by the time I was a grown man, I had so many trades, skills, and professions, it was a crying shame. And as I say, I was working at in the engineering department at Kaiser Aerospace Electronics. You know, and when Ronald Reagan called me a hoodlum, when I led that armed delegation to the California State Legislature, when I led that armed delegation, my organization was only about 6 months old, 6 or 7 months old. I mean, we were a ragtag organization. I'm talking about, what did I have? 15, 16 real members? Then Mark Comfort, he joined with us. Mark Comfort was protesting in his own right against the Tribune, et cetera, the Oakland Tribune. And he joined us. And then we had the Dow brothers and family out in North Richmond. Well, we went out there to check out and deal with Denzel Dow. And we wound up looking one day in Mulford, State Assembly in Mulford, was trying to put a bill through to stop us from observing police. And why did we even go out there for police? Well, I'm going to tell you why. I was later on, and by that time, I'm working for the city government of Oakland, California, Department of Human Resources. I'm the community liaison for the North Oakland Neighborhood Service Center. And what's happening here in that poverty program, that warm poverty program, is 1965 coming around, that book jumped out, Black Power. And I read portions of the book, and then I saw some other brothers standing on the corner. We want Black Power, we want Black Power. Yeah, right on. I says, but you know, we don't have enough politicians, black politicians, to get any Black Power. What you talking about, man? I said, man, you can sit up here, and it's good that you up here, but I says, but we have to have some power, and then we have to have some political power seats. And in that time, working there, et cetera, running the youth jobs program, et cetera, I did my other little research. And I looked across America and tried to find out how many black politicians was duly elected at that time in the middle of the 1960s. How many was elected to office at this time? And I'd gotten up to 50, including Admiral Clayton Powell. I only found 50. Now me, I love mathematics and the demographics and all that stuff, you know what I mean? I says, now wait a minute. How many political seats are there? Yeah, it's 52 counties here in California, boom, 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 et cetera, boom, 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 all this stuff. I says, wow, and I got to looking around and I came up with 500,000 political seats that one can be elected to in the United States of America when you encompass all of them from the lowest local level to the federal level. And most I'd count as 50. Oh, you probably could have found some more, 10 or 15 or 20. But I'm telling the brothers and sisters, y'all, we have to have some political power seats. And this is the real reason that I started the Black Panther Party. This is where it came from. You know, I'm still working for the city government even when we got to the party, you know. Me and Bertrand Morrell, we was on Merritt College there, and we organized a big rally on the campus, you know, that we was not gonna let ourselves fight in the war in Vietnam anymore. I mean, we did a play, we did everything, et cetera, et cetera. And we also put together Black History and got it into the curriculum at Merritt College, et cetera. We were the ones that did the work at my house. My house was right across the street from Merritt College when it was on the flatlands down at the place. And we put that together. We worked at it and put those syllables together, you know? I mean, I remember those days, you know? I had a great job, I had good money, et cetera, and I had to find out more and more history. And I was following up some reference to a Dr. Lorenzo Dow Turner. I had digested this work, Myth of the Negro Past by Marvel J. Herskovitz, some anthropological dissertative thing, you know, destroying and killing all the myths historically through slavery, what have you, et cetera, about us as black folks and so on. And there I was up at Merritt University of California, trying to find this work, Surviving Africanisms, a black language that he had made reference to. And then he told me I couldn't check this out. I says, I can't check it out. Wow, where are you matriculated? I said, I'm down at Merritt College. Blah, blah, blah. Well, you got to have a special library card. Blah, blah. I says, what's that for? He says, it'll cost you $35. I said, here's the $35. Give me this card. Give me this book. And I went and digested that work, and I found out why we dropped all the T-H-E-R-A-R rolling R sounds, why we said dis, dat, dim, yo, mo, and fo, and rather and dropped the T-H-E-R sounds. Because what was happening in growing up, I remembered it, right in one of the Quarternieces village, the teacher, black or white, would take a ruler and hit you on the knuckles. You're speaking pidgin language, and they don't understand, and I didn't understand, the reinforcing inferiority. Yeah. But here, I loved anthropology. You know, I took every anthropology course that Merritt offered at that time. I'm just saying, this is the thing that got me. And all that research about colonialism, et cetera, the exploitation of Africa, and so on, et cetera, blah, 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 this was the one that got me. I was understanding why we said dis, dat, dim, yo, mo, and fo, rather than this, that, them, you're more and for, why we drop the T-H-E-R-A-R rolling R sounds. Dr. Lorenzo Dauterne had done 12 years of field research from Senegal down to Angola, and especially in the English-speaking countries of Ghana and so on, et cetera, boom, boom. There were no T-H-E-R-A-R rolling R sounds in the West African languages. Simultaneously, in another anthropology class, I'm dealing with the eugenics of racism coming out of England and saying that we did not, black folks had never evolved any agricultural sites. And I did a paper on that and found out that's bull crap. Cola nuts, peanuts, et cetera, was first cultivated. The stringy yam was first cultivated in West Africa. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that I was into. And I mean, I could go on and on and on and on and on and on, and on because we got, with those things and the way we put that together, and we put the black history there. At any rate, when I did that rally at Merritt College, we packed the room. I recited this poem called Uncle Sammy Called Me Full of Lucifer. I picked that poem up out of the Liberator magazine out of San Francisco. Out of New York. A young brother wrote that, and I thought it was appropriate to voice a prose piece like that, you know, because we were being drafted to fight in Vietnam, and we read, virtually, and I read in the newspapers that 29% of all the people dying on the front line in Vietnam was black Americans. And we're talking the 1960s, and I'm saying, why should we let ourselves be drafted anymore because this country's not recognizing our constitutional democratic civil human rights? And that's one of the things that protest evolved. With that, Virgil Morell and I created Soul Students Advisory Council at Merritt College here. And that was the beginning. And Huey came down, because I left a message for him, you know, that we have a rally. You know, I talked to Huey at one point before that, right after Malcolm X was killed. And I says, we need to put another organization together. And what Huey says, well, they don't know their history well enough, and I'm in law school now, et cetera, and so on, that kind of stuff. And I says, well, okay, I'm gonna organize something. But after that rally, Huey came at the tail end, and it blew his mind. He looked in the room at the tail end of the rally. We'd been there 3 hours. And all these people was raving about this poem, and Huey had opened the side door. And when I walked out to the side door, me, Virgil, Richard Ioke, and some others, and Huey says, you organize all these people? I says, yeah. I said, I told you, man. I says, it ain't nothing we can organize. But what are you doing now? I says, we're going to my house. What you going to do at your house? I said, I got some barbecue. I cooked a whole lot of ribs and chicken and potato salad and stuff, you know, in the backyard there. And this was for all the people at that rally who had signed up to be members of Soul Students Advisory Council. About 250 of them, about 150 showed up. And Huey was happy to go, because, you know, Huey loved to eat. Yeah, okay, I understand. And he just agrees, you know. My point, though, that those were those early days, you know. But then I also had this job down at the North Oakland Neighborhood Service Center. At another point, I recited that poem up on Telegraph Avenue, and it caused us to get into a fight with the Berkeley police. You know, it had a cuss word in it and all of that, and he walks up, this undercover guy, he didn't even show his badge, walked up saying, "You're using obscene language." And I told him to get his hands off me. He had civilian clothes on. I mean, I didn't know he was a cop. You know, he's talking about I'm under arrest for using obscene language, and I'm cussing him out and telling him that the free speech movement just wanted the right to say the four-letter word all they want to. What you talking about, you know? And they, in the courts, you know, and boom. But we got arrested, wound up in front of Judge Statz over here in the Alameda County Courthouse. And I told the judge, I says, "Your Honor, now my friend Huey here says you can give us 1 to 10 years. John George was with us, but we had to make a statement before sentencing because it was a no contest plea. And I told him, I says, I work with the city government of Oakland. I have youth in the summer for a job program, 100 youth, et cetera. And I work to keep my kids out of jail, but it ain't right. The police lied. He said I was using obscene language, and in a preliminary hearing, he jumped up and said he told me I was blocking the sidewalk. I said he was a liar, Your Honor, and it's not right for me and Huey to be going to jail." Huey, being in law school, says we could get 1 to 10 years, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, the judge gave us probation. And we got downstairs. I said, "Huey, meet me at the Warren Poverty Center tonight." "What?" I said, "I'm telling you, meet me tonight." I says, "Because we're going to finish this." I said, "We could have been in jail, man, for 10 years, man. What's wrong with you?" So we met down there. Everybody was off work. You know, I had the key and everything to get in and out of the place, et cetera, and so on. And we finished writing our rough draft of our 10-point program. And actually, it was October the 10th. And my book sees the time. I wrote that book in jail, and it was a hush, hush, rush book. And I said, somewhere in the middle of October, the 15th of October, we started. But it was the 10th that Judge Statz had said, "Give us probation." And that was when I went and finished writing that program. And we wanted power to determine our own destiny, our own black community. And my whole point was to Huey that we're going to organize a political electoral machine. What? "Yeah, we're going to patrol the police." But you have to understand, patrolling the police was a tactic in this, with guns, law books, and tape recorders. It was a tactic. The idea, as Huey would say, "We'll capture the imagination of the people." I said, "Well, good. If we capture the imagination of the people, then I can help from there begin to organize a political electoral machine." That was the plan. So, yeah, we got these guns, but I already had guns. But big man Albert Howard, he shot a gun over. Richard Aoki gave us 2, 3, 4 guns, you know, and stuff like this. But I trained these brothers. I wouldn't just hand somebody some gun. You know, I'd been in the military service. I knew the necessity of discipline and what have you, et cetera. And Huey, I insisted on him, "You research every law in relation to the guns and our civil rights. Every law. And we want to make sure that we're legal. And if we get arrested, we came out legal, and then therefore we have a better chance." My point, though, is that we did that. We went out there, you know, and I had these brothers trained, you know what I mean? How to break those weapons down and put them back again. Because I, in the military service, I could break down an M1 carbine, you know, blindfold it and put it back together again. That was the type of training I got, even in the Air Force. I mean, we weren't far from the old Army Air Force in 1955 when I went in the United States Air Force. But I'm just saying, this is where we was at in 1966. And we got out there, and this one sister named Geraldine. Now, in the book, I wrote Mata Lava, but I was talking in a tape recorder that she was the first one. But this one particular sister that night was another sister named Geraldine, with the long earrings and the afro, what have you, et cetera. And she couldn't afford a leather jacket. I said, "Sister, just buy... Get a hold of the bush jacket, you know, the black khaki style bush jacket, what have you." And we all had guns, half had legal long guns, half had short guns. But in effect, we knew every law on the guns, every fish and game code law, however the gun was related, whatever, from the Second Amendment rights and all the other rulings, et cetera, we had that down. We knew all of this. And the method was, even Huey had researched it with his law professor. He was in Knight's private law school in San Francisco. You know, is that you can't go and say something first to the police. You have to let the police first say something to you. Because if you say something first, you get busted for interfering with the police officer carrying out their duty, et cetera. So we knew all this stuff. And we get out of the car on 7th Street one night, but the second week of January, on 7th Street, and we walked down, because we saw him. I mean, I had a walkie-talkie. Huey had his father's car. I had my old Chevrolet. I had seven people in my car, and Huey had seven in his car. We was all bunched up in the cars, you know. We parked legally. I mean, I remember that old dumb movie that Melvin Van Peebles made. You know, they had our wheels all up on the curb, and you know what I mean? And then Elderton wrote some old stuff about the baddest dude that ever sit 2 feet inside a hitch yard. And that's that old macho junk. That wasn't how it was at all. We got out of the car and we walked down. Liquor store there, Slim Jenkins is somewhere along the street there on 7th Street, down there and whatever. As we come down, some sister nicely dressed saw us with our little uniforms on, you know, our little berets and our blue shirts and blue whatever, et cetera. Our colors were black and blue with our little guns. It's nighttime, 9 o'clock. Police car's kind of sitting in the street. A little arrestee is standing there with his hand at the back of the trunk. The police is actually on the right side, the passenger side, with the door open, sitting inside, saying something on the radio as we walk up. I get everybody to stand in order, and they do. I said, look, step off the curb. They got off the curb. Some guy came out of the place, about 30, 40 people on the sidewalk there. And the old man say, what they got in their hand, sticks or something? And another brother that knew who he was called him by name and said, man, them guns, be quiet. And so the cop sort of looked up, and then Huey turns around, and the old man said, I'm leaving. And Huey says, no one leave, please stay here. You have a right to stand and observe, police officer. We researched the law, so no one leave, everybody stand. By this time, this cop's got out in his car, and Huey turns around, and the cop says, you have no right to observe me. And Huey says, no, California State Supreme Court ruling states that every citizen has a right. Wait a minute. You got to hear this out. I'm telling you, we're reciting the law. Huey says, no, California State Supreme Court ruling states that every citizen has a right to stand and observe a police officer carrying out their duty as long as they stand a reasonable distance away or reasonable distance. That particular ruling is constituted 8 to 10 feet. I'm standing approximately 20 feet from you, and we'll observe you whether you like it or not. And the sister on the sidewalk, she says, well, go ahead on and tell it. Now, I mean, when I look back on that, and what was happening here is we're capturing the imagination of the people. We're disciplined. Nobody's one person. Because the point, and the other point we told everybody, only one person talk. Because when we're arrested, we want to be able to go to court, and I want if it's 12, 13, or 14 of us to be able to testify to the same thing. We had that thing laid out there. Anyway, that cop says, is that gun loaded? Huey says, if I know it's loaded, it's good enough. Well, I have a right. Huey says, no, you have no right. Huey cited something, United States Supreme Court, blah, 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 blah. Therefore, you cannot remove my property from it without due process of law. Step back. You cannot touch my weapon. And a tall black brother over there, he say, man, what kind of Negro is these? That's the way it happened. Right there in West Dunkin' on 7th Street. You know, and boom, the cop says, well, Huey says, you can't touch my weapon, step back. You know what I mean? And boom, He said, load it. And then Huey says, clack, clack. He jacked a round in the chamber. Now, it was not a round in the chamber, that shotgun I'd bought Huey. Why? Because it was a law. While riding in the car, you cannot have a live round in a long gun such as a shotgun or a rifle while riding in the car. You could put it in the chamber where it could be shot once you got out of the car. He was says, clack, clack, he jacks around in the chamber. And when he jacks around in the chamber, all the other guys with long guns, clack, 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 clack. Well, that shook up everybody. That caused the cop. See, the police officer really hadn't looked down to see. I had 14 other people down here with all these guns. You know, and bow, and he looks, he gets his arrestee, he puts him in the car, he's walking away, and he stops. The sister had these gold earrings on, and the light, whatever, was flicking, and he stopped to guess, obviously to try to make sure one of them is a woman. With a big 44 pistol that Richard Aoki had given her to wear. My point is, and he left, the police left. Some kids come running around the corner, telling some other kids, see, I told you, look at that. These are the new police to us. And I was, but I'm telling you, that was it. And we went back to my house. And you know I love to cook, you know what I mean? So I always had food for people working with me. I learned that mostly from my people on the farm, et cetera. But when I went in the military service, you'll be messing around, man. Met your people out here doing all that. Well, you better get some food out of here. You know, I always put food in framework. Even when I created the Free Breakfast for Children program. I'm just saying that was what that was about. And my idea is that once we get the people going, but for that whole year, you know, from 66 to when we never had no more than 50 people in the Black Panther Party the first year. See, people may have thought we didn't have no big numbers, but May 2nd, halfway through that year, is when I led the armed delegation. That event, you know, and it was just an event because Moffitt was up there for me to read executive mandate number one. And that's what I did. And then I wanted to go into the Capitol inside. I wanted to go to the spectator section because citizens have a right to somewhere sit in here. And man, I didn't know where it was. And a horde of 40, 50 press people are saying, this way, Bobby. We got guns, cameras, everything. Five people get ahead of me. Mark Comfort and others got ahead of me with their rifles, and they walked in on the assembly floor. I didn't know what it was, they got ahead of me. And I walked up, I'm looking for the spectator section. We're on the floor, and the president pro tip is banging. The press, pow, pow, is not allowed. On the cameras came rushing into the assembly. Cameras were not allowed on the floor while the assembly was in session. It was not allowed, and I said, oh my God, we're in the wrong place. I mean, this is where I come from, you know what I mean? I come down and I'm walking down the aisle because they had walked all the way up front. The president pro tip didn't even realize that the guy, that I had five people ahead of me with rifles on their shoulder, resting on their shoulder, you know? And boom, and I said, come on, you guys, let's get out of here, man, we're in the wrong place. And so a couple of white guys had ducked under the table. I said, hey man, I'm sorry, they led me to the wrong place, come on. This is really how it happened. Now, we had left the Capitol and they came and arrested us. We were well gone, long gone. We were sitting in the service station, et cetera. You know, they came and surrounded us and arrested us, what have you, et cetera. And they didn't arrest any of the women. We had six females, but they include my first wife, Artie. And she was with me. And we had six carloads, what have you. And later that night, Eldridge Cleaver's girlfriend, she was his lawyer, came and bailed me out. And I got back down. Anyway, a day or so later, I got my brother-in-law, Ted Williams, to bail out my people, et cetera. And then when we got before the court, they only charged 6 people. But they had our guns, so we went down to the police area to get our guns. We're not giving you any guns back. You can't have any guns back. We went back and went to the court, got Beverly Axelrod, the lawyer, to tell the judge that they only charged us with disturbing the peace. There's no gun charges at all, and we want our guns back. And the judge ruled, and we've been back there and got our guns. The cops hated giving us those guns back. Got our guns. And our guns were loaded. They were loaded. We would not go out there with unloaded guns just in case something really happened. I'm just saying. And we took the chance with that, you know what I mean? Now, that was all about police brutality, and it was focus. But my organization and us starting with the guns had more to do with the fact that peaceful protesters right here in Berkeley and Oakland was viciously brutalized. And peaceful protesters, you see, that's what was wrong, you know what I mean? That whole year, we had no more than 50 people in the party. I had to serve 6 months, which I got out of jail in 5 months because of good behavior. But my point is, that was in December, and Huey was in jail, shot, et cetera, what have you, by Officer Fry, and so on. Now, I can't tell you the whole history of that. You can read about that, sky's the limit, et cetera, and so on. I got other books outside, but my point is, the real growth of my organization really started in 1968. I come out of jail December the 8th. Eldridge Cleaver was riding high. I ain't got no job no more, so Norvell Smith had to let me go. You know what I mean? But he came back, he says, Bobby, what are you doing going to the Capitol like this here? I said, man, I'm just trying to change this stuff right here. He said, they're making me fire you. I said, that's all right, Norvell, man. Fine, don't worry about that. You know what I mean? But my point is, it was really there in that period. And we did the pre-Huey birthday rally. And right after that, Dr. Reverend Ralph Abernathy called me. And Mr. Seale, he says, Dr. King would like to know, would you, would the Black Panther Party, be willing to help participate in organizing for his upcoming Poor People's March? And I says, yes, yes. I says, he says, we are organizing more than 100 different organizations from all across the country in various cities all across the country. I says, okay. I says, we will participate. We will definitely participate. And I says, he says, well, what we're going to do, he says, once we get this 100 or so organizations together, Dr. King wants to set up a broad round table where we can deal with spelling out and broaden the civil rights in terms of economic rights. This is what we're going to do. And I said, well, we will participate, we'll be a part. So in effect, for people don't know it, I had a coalition with SCLC and Martin Luther King. And then Eldridge Cleaver next week put in the Black Panther Party newspaper, my Dr. Martin Luther King, calling him a bootlicker. Oh my God. Me and Eldridge Cleaver went around. He was the Minister of Information. I said, you are not going to do that. Oh, Chairman, he's talking about now. I said, you darn right, nonviolence. I says, nonviolence is a constitutional, democratic, civil, human right. I says, and for anybody to beat up peaceful protesters is violating the law of the land. So we defend our constitutional, democratic, civil, human rights. That's where we're coming from. I says, now, I told Dr. King, we will participate, and those Black Panthers who don't want to come up there, I says, boy, there will be no guns coming when we come to your Poor People's March. But anyway, we packed the Oakland Auditorium for the Poor People's March. I packed that auditorium, and then Dr. Reverend Ralph Abernathy and others, they organized, and that's what we did in the few chapters I had. I mean, really, my chapters were just up and down the West Coast. And that first year before Dr. King was killed, I only had 400 members up and down the West Coast, from San Diego to Seattle, Washington. That's all I had. And that coalition, what? 5 weeks later, they murdered Dr. King. And what, the next thing I know, some judge was gonna violate my probation. And then a riot happened in Richmond, California. And I ran out to Richmond, California, where I had put up a youth jobs program, the first youth jobs program. In fact, the city government of Richmond, California, back here 10 years ago, gave me a proclamation for creating the first youth jobs program. And it was right at the time in 1964 when the Civil Rights Bill was passed. I quit my engineering job after 3.5 years just to work in the grassroots community. And that's what I created out there, that youth jobs program behind the Civil Rights Bill. You know, but when they, Dr. King, what happened, it caused riots was all over the country. I didn't believe in riots at all. I believed in organizing people. That's what I believed in. Because even prior to the Black Panther Party and the Watts riots, which was in 1965, we didn't start the Black Panther Party until October 1966. All right? So then I remember that Watts riot. We up here in Oakland, and that was in Los Angeles and all that stuff. What? 65 killed, 200 some odd wounded, and 5,000 arrested. And this is before the party started, and I'm working in my head, how can I organize 5,000 people rather than 5,000 people just get in the grassroots community so we can get some more political power seats? You see, and these guys were political power seats. I said, yeah, man, they got counties all over the South, man, where the majority of Black folks are in those counties. In each county, a sheriff is elected. I says, now if we got the right to vote, we get the people registered to vote. I says, what? We can elect some really heavy, progressive Black sheriff, and if the Ku Klux Klan get to acting up, that sheriff can deputize 100 brothers and sisters and people and go over there and kick that Ku Klux Klan's butt and stop them from doing that. I said, that's political power, man. We want some power seats. Oh, okay, man. I said, understand. So the city council sees that they make the laws, man. They make the rules, et cetera, the city charter. I said, don't you understand? This is what this is about. And that was my political organizing strategy. As the party, and Dr. King was killed, people were running, joining my organizations, hand over fist. I'm going to every chapter and every branch. We need to get you out here. I said, go to the college, get the college, invite me to speak out there. They will pay me to speak. They'll pay all our expenses, et cetera. And boom, and once I speak to the college, that starts your community base that we communicate with the college and wherever you're located in your city, et cetera. Then the next day or the next evening, I'll give you guys a prayer. So I went to these chapters and branches to teach them the fine particulars and the methodology of effective grassroots community organizing. That's what it was about to me. That's the way I saw it. In other words, if I drew, I'm an architect, et cetera. I can draw the beautifulest plans, et cetera, do all the specs and specifications, et cetera, take them down to license inspection, et cetera, boom, boom, they can pass them. It's still just a theory. But when you build it, it's real. You see what I mean? So that's the concept. So my idea is I'm gonna build an electoral machine in this country in chapters and branches everywhere. In other words, we was rolling through 1968. A lot of things happened, et cetera. By the time Nixon was elected, my organization had moved from 400 members up and down the West Coast to 5,000 members in 49 chapters and branches throughout the United States of America. That's how fast we had rapidly moved. And it was in reaction to the murder of our beloved Dr. Martin Luther King. This is what the real program was and what really happened. And then they put too much doctrinaire socialism in our party newspaper, and I got tired of that. You know, simultaneously, what happened? I think Nixon was elected. After Nixon was elected, he had a meeting before he was sworn in with J. Edgar Hoover. The first week or so in December, Nixon's still not sworn in. Nixon is on the mass media, and this is the first time he heard that the Black Panther Party is a threat to the internal security of America. And when he said that, and I went to look the views, and I says, whoa. And I didn't swole to 5,000 members. And so when I says, wow, I called for a retreat. I said, well, every little chapter in every branch, I want 2, 3, or 4 people out of the branch. They got a week to get here to Oakland, California. I want them here now. And that's what I gave a directive. And everything, and they made it there. They made it here to Oakland. Places we could meet with St. Augustine's Church, another church they call the Black Church, where they let us use some Lutheran group, et cetera, and so on. Well, but anyway, that's when I took my little architectural skills and I start sketching, architecturally sketching, how to structure framings and fortify all of our offices, because they are going to attack us. And I kept telling the problem, you don't take this lightly. When this man said we are a threat to the internal security of America, I believe J. Edgar Hoover and these people getting ready to attack us. And that's what was happening. And as Nixon gets sworn in, and in research for my own film, that me and Stephen Evans right there standing there, he's part of me in my program, with standing by that camera there of our film. Stephen had found a research piece out of one of those archives frameworks right after Nixon was sworn in. Old Watergate tapes that had been made public. And he sent that thing to me, and there it was. Nixon, Richard M. Nixon. Now, J. Edgar, you're gonna do these Black Panthers for me, J. Edgar. Well, yes, sir. I says, when you gonna move on these Black Panthers? He says, well, we've been trying to move on. He says, well, you do it. Now John Mitchell's gonna be calling you. I mean, we ain't been charged with nothing yet. And these guys are talking about getting rid of us. You see what I'm getting at? This is what was happening. So it was the President of the United States. Yeah, that film, you know, talked about that, and J. Edgar Hoover did this, but I want to say this is what Nixon did, that president. That's where the fascism rolled from. And in that year of 1969, they must have attacked over 20 different Black Panther Party offices, raided them. In one couple of places, just ran in there. Brothers was just opening the office up, didn't even know they were coming, boom, 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 shot it up, Brother Bell down in Los Angeles, just killed him dead, et cetera. It went all over the place. I mean, that was, by the end of that year, I had 28 party members dead, 69 wounded. And in defending ourselves in a lot of these situations, there were 12 police officers dead. And 39 police officers, because we defended ourselves. They came to us, and they tried to call us terrorists. They was the one that terrorizing us. You know what I mean? We weren't no terrorists. So what Dr. King did in his move to get all these organizations involved, and also he told us we wanted a round table where we work together and meet on some basis, where we help to work out and outline a broad plan for greater economic rights. And I says, yes, sir. I understood it. I understood the whole relevancy of where he was coming from. In effect, the Black Panther Party wound up being coalesced with 30-some-odd different organizations. I didn't just have what you call statement coalitions. I had to have face-to-face relationships. All my Chicano brothers and organizations, the Latino brothers, all the young lords and other people, et cetera, all the little young Asians, the Red Guard, the Iwakun in New York, what have you, et cetera. This is the kind of coalitions we had. And then I called for a United Front Against Fascism conference right here in Oakland, California in the summer of 1969. And they were still attacking our offices all across the country. Finally, they arrested me August the 8th that year. Already forced Eldridge into exile. Huey was already in jail, convicted, and sentenced. But Huey was found not guilty of first-degree murder, not guilty of second-degree murder, and found guilty only of third-degree voluntary manslaughter. To understand that, that's half of a win, because they were talking about putting him in an electric chair. Did they have an electric chair or gas chamber out here? I forget. Anyway, they were going to put me in the electric chair. They were going to put me in the electric chair. In New Haven, Connecticut. But before New Haven, Connecticut, I had to go through Chicago. And that story, that's a mean story. Nobody can get it right, but I got it right. I wrote, no, I got it right because I experienced it. You know what I mean? It was three levels of gagging. The third level of gagging, the artist never had a chance to draw it because that was one of them situations where they brought me in the chair. Counselor is up out of his chair, again telling the judge this is medieval torture. The jury members over there, a couple of them were crying, I think. But me, I'm over here battling to try to turn my arm up under this big hospital strap. This is the third day. See, in the first day, they put me in a little folding, metal folding chair. You know what I mean? And Mr. Seale, will you be quiet now? And I had metal cut my way. I had metal handcuffs on a metal folding chair. Clang, 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 clang. You're not going to have no court today with Bobby Seale sitting here. He ain't gagged today. Clang, clang, clang. And I'm saying, I want my constitutional right. You give me my constitutional right. That's what I was doing. So, I mean, I have a dynamic hell of a story that young folks, people, and others need to see on the big screen. And this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to do this. To let them understand what the real story was about. All the counterintelligence program crap and all the lies and all the distortions, et cetera, which is still going on. Still going on. They tried to set me up here recently. Some old fake group of supposed to be for the Israeli people. And I stand on the right of the Israelis to defend themselves, but at the same time, I want the Palestinians to have a level of human liberation. See, at the same time. My point is, and they was working through, in other words, they're still doing it. The Koch brothers, hey, now, they sent out 3 years ago, first 5 years ago, I spoke at Seminole University, packed house. And I arrived a day early. The professor showed me on the internet that the Tea Party said they're coming out against you. I'm looking at it and says, I'm an old, dirty, rotten socialist, Bobby. And we are proud of everything the FBI did to the Black Panthers. And we're going to protest Bobby Seale coming here to Seminole University here in Florida, et cetera, blah, 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 blah. So the next day, they have 600 seats. They have to get 400 more seats. The place packs. 60 of these Tea Party guys walk in with their green hats and their green sweaters, what have you, et cetera, and their little placards, blah, 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 in the back. They introduce me. Well, some people must know the history because half the people jumped up and applauded when I was introduced. And then I blew. I blew for a whole hour. I talked about them dudes so bad. Them, the Koch brothers are in. Koch brothers sent out, after that, the Koch brothers sent out to over 1,200 universities syllabus for teaching. They wanted their economic courses taught in these universities. And they sent these to some Black universities, too. And they had grants with them, big-time grants for departments and universities. The Koch brothers financed the Tea Party student-type organizations on the campuses. They did, all across America. My speaking engagements, in 2 years after that, I got no speaking engagements in Black History Month. I didn't get no. Oh, dang, these guys are organized against me. You know, so I had to get on there and get me a Facebook and do everything else just to get me come back up, you know, to. So to this day, I'm only doing four or five or six engagements. I used to do 10 and 12 engagements. I mean, when I was doing those engagements way back there, 20 engagements, et cetera, my middle son, Romaine, boy, we got that guy through medical school, you know, boom, boom. That boy's a doctor now. He's a big-time surgeon, Children's Hospital down in Texas, what have you, et cetera. You know, those are the things we want for every last one of our kids and our youth, you know what I mean? You know, my oldest son wound up fighting in Iraq. He was in Army Reserve, you know, and come back here. And I say, wow, my son fought in Iraq, and he came back wounded from Afghanistan. You know, but my point is, we still caught up in these wars. We was always caught up in the wars from the very beginning. When I researched Back in the day when I was researching all that history, Dr. Herbert Aptak had documented all those wars we had fought in, all the way back to the Colonial War. The German Hussian soldiers that the king had put together and was getting ready to send them over here, and Lafayette was up there telling the guys in New England, y'all ragtag, you better promise some of these blacks here their freedom instead of train them to help you fight. But when those German Hussian soldiers months later landed at Rhode Island, who kicked their butts? Them black African soldiers. I'm talking about that's one of the first colonial wars. Yes, Crispus Attucks, but this is other stuff I'm trying to tell you. You know what I mean? And then World War I, World War II, boom, 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 boom. We've been there. And I say we first-class citizens. Even if they treat me like a second-class citizen, we are first-class citizens. We have to learn and think that. We have to learn and think that. And I tell you, if you're homeless, whatever, et cetera, you have to keep telling yourself, I'm a first-class human being. I'm a first-class citizen. So I'm just saying, minds be over and beyond some of the transgressions of my buddy, my friend Huey made in the latter part of the days of the Black Panther Party, you know, et cetera, and so on. But beyond all of that, minds was about that, my ideology was about power to the people. And to me, power to the people begets, if we can put it together, greater cooperational humanism. And this whole need for us to tackle this climate change, sorry, anyway, look here, look, it is about our constitutional democratic civil human rights. At the 10-point, that tail end of my 10-point platform and program, I put the first, paraphrasing of the first two paragraphs of the Declaration of Independence, United States of America. And I try to get young folks to really read that. Because when I put it there, I had read it, digested, and understood it for what it was. It said, when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for any one people to dissolve the political bondage which have connected us with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and nature's God entitled us, a decent respect to the opinions of humankind dictates that they should declare the causes which impel them to get rid of that political bondage that they're subjected to. And the latter part of it, listen to me, it says, when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursues and invariably evinces a design to reduce a people under absolute despotism, then it is the right of the people to alter a change and provide new guards for their security and happiness. So my argument and my organizing, my very organizing was trying to get some political power seats. And Congresswoman Barbara Lee, oh my God, I've been knowing this sister that time. She told me I put them all out in the field, registering people to vote. So I'd forgotten about it. I put 20 people in the field one day. But that was what it's about. I want them political power seats. By the end of the 1970s, with a lot of people participating on that same line, we had 7,000 duly elected black politicians in the United States of America. By the end of the 80s, by the end of the 80s, we had 10, 11, 12,000. In the 90s, I think we're near somewhere 20. But it's more than that. When we said all power to the people, we're talking about those same political power seats. Those political power seats are legislative frameworks. They make laws. They allocate monies, funds, et cetera, blah, 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 blah. You know what I mean? And you see what the right wing is doing. We know what they're doing, especially with their repression of the vote. I mean, we pull together and get these people out here and get these young folks and everybody together out here, boom, 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 boom. We got to take back, I mean, yeah, we got, what, 90 representatives that will tend to vote on a progressive level. We need three times that many in the House of Representatives. And we get the, see, that's the kind of stuff, and that's still the same issue. Those political power seats in a progressive way, with progressive thinking, with good politics, et cetera, boom, boom. That's what it's about. It's about a future world of cooperational humanism. It's a continuing human liberation struggle. Power to the people. Thank you very much.
One more round of applause. We have a student here, Dariana, from Oakland Tech Upper Campus, would like to present something to Mr. Seale.
Thank you, Mr. Seale, for your wonderful speech. You remind us that our fight isn't finished. We, the generation of the now, must understand that it is our job to pick up the baton from previous generations. We have to continue the action of vigorous campaigning to bring about change. The problems we face aren't new. In the past, we struggled towards getting the rights that we deserved and the treatment owed to us. As things got better, we began to forget. When the struggle of oppression started to resurface, we treated it as if it was new. The problems we face aren't new. You reminded us that when we start treating things as if it was new, it's just become just as delayed. We refuse, organizations like the Black Panther Party reminded us that justice delayed is justice denied. And we refuse to be denied. Bobby Seale, you refuse to be denied. You put hope into the future. You started a free breakfast program in 1969. You believe that by feeding the youth, you're feeding the revolution. We see what you have done, and we, the youth, will live up to your expectations. Tonight, we honor you for all your dedicated work that you have accomplished for justice and freedom here and throughout the nation. We're thankful for your powerful message. And on behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center and Merritt College, we offer you this token of our appreciation for your service.
At this time, I would just like to remind everyone that out in the lobby, we have signed copies of Mr. Seale's books, DVDs, and posters. And again, on behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center and Merritt College, we want to thank all of you who are in attendance personally and those who are live streaming across the nation. Thank you very much.
Can I say something? I want to say something. The 50th anniversary of the Black Panther Party will be celebrated in the month of October. I'm doing some special programs that we're trying to put together. At the same time, I'm going to introduce, hopefully, because I'm looking for another grant to come through, hopefully, my Environmental Renovation Youth Jobs Projects. If you know anything about my history, I'm a programmatic person. I put real programs up that's real and makes sense. So that's one of the things. So for every book that you buy from me, or every DVD that you buy from my wife and other people out there, you're helping me to put this whole program together. Thank you very much.
Roy, can I have you upstairs? Roy.
Roy.
Okay, go.